With campuses in Vijayawada and in Hyderabad, the capital of startup state Telangana, KL brings 38 years of engineering excellence in shaping the complete student. KL University employs higher order teaching pedagogies, driven by globally renowned faculty. State-of-the-art research department with additional focus on industry-driven skilling have been paramount in attracting 500-plus MNCs to engage with KL, resulting in an impeccable track record of 100% placement over the last 14 years.
At KL University, we concentrate on overall development of the student. Along with the academics, we give equal importance for all-round development of the student.
The faculty at KL is made up of eminent faculty from premier institutions in India and across the globe. With more than 500 faculty holding PhDs and 550 more pursuing PhDs, KL leaves no stone unturned in edifying higher education. Academics at KL are divided between our faculty and a roster of acclaimed international and guest faculty. The usage of teaching pedagogies like flipped classroom, project-based learning, empirical learning, and deep and blended learning, faculty at KL certify a holistic education for every student. Lab taken to class allows students to receive a more hands-on education, which leaves them with a deeper understanding of concepts and practices. Our fully flexible choice between credit system empowers the student to hold the reins of their education. Skilling is about adding another dimension and expertise to a student's arsenal. We keep our eyes on the future, while our feet firmly rooted in the present. In an exciting association with National Skill Development Council and engaging the best in the industry and domain experts, KL has introduced methods to educate students in skills necessary for the future, like big data and analytics, Internet of Things, artificial intelligence and machine learning, cybersecurity and forensics, applied signal processing, robotics, renewable energy, and many more. Technical clubs in all the departments allow students to interact with like minds and grow further. Research in all domains is given as much importance as academics. KL is at the forefront of industrial and academic research, with 2,000 plus active researchers, 7,000 plus research publications, and 50 plus patents. Needs of the common man are the most important for us at KL. Be it our research in big data, helping us to map out weather patterns, to enhance satellite communications, or map DNA. The government of India supports our endeavors fully, as evidenced by their aid in the form of more than rupees 40 crore. Everything at KL is geared towards providing our students a clear shot at their dream career. All registered students over the past 14 years have placed to companies, resulting in our proud 100% placement rate. More than 50 companies have offered salaries larger than 5 lakhs annum in 2017 and 18. KL provides launch pads for the career progressions of every individual student. Coaching and mentoring services are available for GRE, TOEFL, IELTS, GATE, and civil service. To further hone the entrepreneurial spirit, we have a government-sanctioned business incubator and center for innovation and entrepreneurship to nurture student-led startups. Life at KL is a plethora of great times spent with like-minded people in an environment conducive to creativity and growth. We host national-level techno and cultural fests, where students are given a platform to display their talent and more than 70 hobby clubs to explore said talent. They stay fit at our world-class sports arenas and gyms, and nourished at their choice of 8 multi-cuisine cafeterias. As a testament to excellence, KL is an NAACA grade accredited university and has formed partnerships with over 64 foreign universities with exchange programs to deliver a truly global exposure to our students. Semester abroad and twinning programs give the students a global exposure. With its sights set far above the horizon, KL is bringing global education to everyone with their launch of the new campus in Hyderabad. designed by the world-renowned architects Woods Bagot, the state-of-the-art campus is being built to international standards. It's easy to be part of the crowd and follow, but it's difficult to be different and stand out. At KL, we do not believe in simply teaching. We believe in creating global personalities who stand out with KL. KL, deemed to be university.
Thank you. A very good morning, delegates, guests, and dear participants. We, Department of Computer Engineering from KL University, feel proud and good at heart to travel with you last 5 days, and now finally came to the 6th day of faculty development program. Yesterday, we had a good time in sharing knowledge with Mr. Vishnu Indukuri Garu and Mr. M. Venkataramu Garu from USA. Today, we are going to meet another eminent person, Mr. Ravi Kumar Garu, Data Engineer, Oracle, Malaysia. Filtering the eminent personalities in this ocean is the biggest task. RHOD Dr. M. Shivaganga Prasad Garu, no doubt, fight with the waves and take out the best people to introduce to the participants. I request him to welcome M. Ravi Kumar Garu for today's session. Sir, please.
Yeah. Good morning, madam. Good morning, everyone. And heartily welcome all the participants for last session. I know the participants from beginning onwards, from first day to today, the way of interest and the way of dedication to attend this program, even if it is in online, really appreciate, and I'm very much thankful to you all for showing your interest to attend this particular faculty development program. From beginning onwards, the speakers has given a wonderful sessions, hands-on sessions and all. Really, the participants are enjoying a lot, I hope. Even for today also, the last day, the way of your attending and encouragement and showing your interest to attend this FDP is really appreciable. And in this regard, I'm heartily welcome Mr. K. Ravi Kumar, Senior Data Engineer, Oracle International, Malaysia. Sir, I'm very happy to see you like this, sir. Hearty welcome, and I'm extending my sincere thanks to you for accepting your invitation in spite of your busy schedule, sir. Thank you so much for your kind and heart acceptance for our faculty development program as a resource person. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much. And really, our organizers are doing very well from beginning onwards. So even today also, last day, the way of interest of the faculty members is really good, and the participants are also showing wonderful interest. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, Ravi Kumar Garu. You please carry.
Yeah, thank you very much, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to talk about big data analytics and data science areas. First of all, I would like to thank the management for giving me this such a beautiful opportunity to interact with the huge number of audience. Hope I am able to hear. I'm audible, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sorry to interrupt you. Just 2 seconds. We need to have an introductory about you, sir.
Sure.
So, thank you, HOD, sir. Dear participants, we have here Mr. M. Ravi Kumar Garu, Data Engineer, Oracle from Malaysia. Let's introduce them before going to into the session and grab his knowledge to into this session. M. Ravi Kumar Garu, Data Scientist, Data Engineer, ASEA, and Big Data Analyst. His education qualifications goes with MCA, PGP in Big Data Analyst and Optimization from International School of Engineering. His certifications goes with Scrum Alliance Certified Scrum Master, Oracle Certified Certificate Specialist in OBIEE. Going on to his experiences, he has more than 9 years of strong experience in project exclusion experience in application development, infrastructure management, service delivery, big data, data science, data analyst across the various routes of Oracle language. Certified Scrum Master, Oracle Certified Specialist in Oracle Business Intelligence Foundation Suite, and insightful experience in managing data warehouse, architecture, design, and development, including Hadoop, Spark, and Hadoop ecosystems. Skilled in leading big data analyst project from data acquisition in preparation to presentation layer. Expert and excellent interpersonal communication and organizational skills with proven quality change management and client relationship management. Just going on to the recent consulting experience, he worked as a big data engineer in CIMB Bank Malaysia, part of a development team, Oracle, DBA, VDR set up for backup and recovery of cloud era based Oracle VDA environment. And he worked as a data scientist on British Telecom, data scientist to create ML algorithms for clustering and other supervised and unsupervised algorithms, and data analyst as a data analyst using different routing tools in Malaysia, and BI developer as a BI apps in implementation using OBIEE and ODI in Malaysia. And going on to the application developer, he worked there as a Oracle financial service analytical application integration with business intelligence in Oracle. Here we have an eminent personality, Mr. M. Ravikumar Garu, to share his views with us. Participants, we are lucky here, and let us listen to him, and we can ask queries and doubts at the last session ending. Thank you. Thank you very much. Have a nice day, dear participants. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much. Let me just take 2 minutes of your time to just get into the more about my skill set and my work experience in these tools into big data analytics and my current projects. I work as a data scientist. I started my career as a BA developer, and I work on different reporting tools from Oracle, and then I started working with the different clients as a data analyst, data scientist, and big data engineer. My recent projects was the backup and disaster recovery for the big data production cluster. This is some unique and different experience which I would like to share with you all. This is the project. Whenever the production cluster has gone down, then there might be some backup mechanism for the data and all. But if the production cluster has to be, it will take some time, some longer time, maybe 1 week or 10 days sometimes in a failure scenario to get back to the normal situation. So in that case, obviously the production business is going to impact, and the resource has to be sit ideal. So to mitigate that risk, we have been suggested to the customer to create a backup disaster recovery environment. So it is going to replicate the entire production cluster where they can immediately they can switch back to the disaster recovery environment, and they can start doing their work. So the entire data engineering team and data scientist team and everybody is going to depend on that production cluster, right? So how it is important to the environment, especially for the banking client. So if it is down, then we may not get reflected our IMF transfers or whatever the transactions we have made. So to mitigate that kind of risk, this is the backup and disaster recovery environment is going to help them. I think going forward, most of the companies is going to implement such products. I would say this is just the starting of this. We recently has been created this kind of products. Okay. So then I would like to talk about the data science first. So here today, I would like to talk about the data science, and then I would like to take one real-time problem and how we can solve that real-time problem. I will show you how we can write the code and how we can what is the business case and how we are going to solve that problem. So how it is helping us in the real time, how it is going to reduce the manual intervention to solve some typical problems in the real time. So I'm going to show. Okay, let me share my screen. So, okay, let me start from here. Okay, this is the, data is the sword of the 21st century. Okay, that is nothing but data is a weapon for the 21st century. There is no other weapon is required.
Ravi sir, sorry to disturb you. Can we have the slideshow, please?
Sorry, yeah.
Slideshow.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yeah. Data is the sword of 21st century. So this is the word has been given by the chief advisor of Laurie Page, the CEO of Google, Jonathan Rosenberg. Okay. So why is data science, how it is going to help the industry as well as career wise to the students, why the data science is needed? Because in going forward, because we have been computerized since a long time, and we have lots of data with us. So once we have the lot of data, then we can do something out of the data to get some better insights out of the data. So which can help us to predict our business, which can help us to run our business in a better way. So that is how the data can be used. We have to make use of that feasibility, as we have the data, that is our strength now. Today, that is our very biggest strength. So we can make use of the data and we can predict our business. How my business is going to perform in the next year, or how my business is going to perform in the next month. Those kind of things we can be done if we have enough data with us. So as based out of this, going forward for the next 10 years, the data scientist job is the most demanding job, and this industry is going to provide a lot of opportunities. So especially the career oriented students who can focus on these data science technologies. So this is one of the most good sentence I have been heard in the data science area. Simple models do better than experts. What does it mean? So for example, if we have a model built on based out of our data, then it is going to solve our problem of segregating the data based out of how the experts is going to segregate the data. Say for example, I would like to take one example based out of a hospitalization system. Every day there are a lot of tickets is going to come get the hospitals regarding the new appointments or lab related things or doctor advisors, whatever it is, insurance related things, many things we can get it. So based out of this, for several examples, thousands of SRs we may get it every day, service request or the tickets, whatever you call it as. So based out of these inputs, somebody has to pick these tickets and they have to segregate this data and they have to send these tickets to the concerned departments. Then only that is very big task among the segregation of this data. So for that, we need an experts who can able to read the data, and they should be able to understand the data, and they should be able to segregate, okay, this is related to incidence domain, this is related to some other new appointment things, so this is related to lab, so they have to send it to the different areas, the service request or tickets. So for that, there are a lot of expertises required, there are a lot of manual intervention is there. So there are many people, it will take longer time as well, because some descriptions are having very huge data, so which they have to understand, they have to read the data, whole data, and then only they can able to assign it to the lab department or the appointment department or doctor prescription or medical shop, whatever it is. So for that, it will take a lot of manual intervention. So if we can build a model out of it, which can able to do all this job, then it is going to solve our problem, right? So it is as simple as that. If we can build the model, then that will take care of it. That can send the data to the different areas. So that is here. Simple models do better than experts. This is a justification. This is the example of justification for this slide. Okay, many people are heard about artificial intelligence, machine learning, predictive analytics, data mining, data analytics, data science. So there are so many areas. There are so many terms. But apart from that will confuse, that will make create confusion to the students and many people who is new to the industry, this particularly to the data science area. So I would like to just give a clarification out of it, where the terms are terms came from and how it has been used by the people. The machine learning started in 1980s. Okay, the computing department, which is named as machine learning. That the machine learning is, which is going to focus on the algorithm and the amount of data was limited during that time, because machine learning, that is where we need a deep learning, where we have the huge number of data. We are going to the deep learning models instead of machine learning models. So machine learning can be applied, or the techniques can be applied to the data where we have some small amount of data. Whereas if we have the large number of huge number of data, then we can probably go for a deep learning models to get the better results. Predictive analytics. This is the term which has been started from 1990s. The business world is started adopting this word as data analytics, using that algorithms are developed and somewhere developed and applied on the large amount of data. Say, for example, if you need to build an algorithm, we can take some CSV data or Excel data and taking just some 50,000 records out of it. And we're building the model and training the model and checking the accuracy, how it is being performing. Then we are going to deploy this model in the real-time big data environment. So where it is going to run on the real-time data analytics to forecast the results. Because our CSV data, it's a static. It's not a real-time. This is just been used to build the model. That's it. It will not predict the real-time data. So to the same model can be deployed in the big data environment where it can run that. We can provide the streaming of data. That means that is nothing but real-time data. If we can supply the real-time data, then it is going to perform on the real-time data to give the real-time predictions. Big data analytics is started from 2000s onwards. What is big data analytics? Big data analytics is nothing but earlier we used to have only the structured data. We never have these videos. Once we have the Google, YouTube, Facebook, and all this stuff, then the data is become larger and larger every day by day. The unstructured data is came into the picture, like image data, like videos, audios, image, log files, emails. There are different unstructured data came into the picture. So once we have the unstructured data, then we have the big data environment. Then only we can able to process the data, because it is difficult. It is difficult to save the data in a computer and process that. We can save it, but we cannot able to process it. So if we have the big data environment, so that we can able to process the same data using that big data, clustering techniques, we can using the HDFS, Hadoop file systems, distributed computing of Hadoop file systems, we can able to process the data parallelly. So where it can give the better performance, and also it can able to handle the structured data, unstructured data as well. Yeah, now this term is data science. Now everybody is calling it as a data science. The entire, all this stuff, machine learning, artificial intelligence, big data analytics, if you can combine all this stuff, we can call it as a data science. So the data science, basically, if the person is enthusiastic to data, learn the data science and wanted to pursue the career in data science, they should be good in the visualization as well. Because whenever if you have some data, if you can able to visualize the data, then only you can able to do the better, you can write the better predictive algorithms over there. If you don't understand the data, you cannot able to write the algorithm, because depends on your data, you have to pick your algorithm. Depends on your data, you have to you have to find it out whether it is there. Whether it is going to fall under supervised algorithm or unsupervised algorithm, or what kind of algorithm has to be picked, and what type of data it is, whether it is numerical data, categorical data, so do we need to convert the data really? So these are all the pre-processing. These are all, we can call it as the pre-processing steps in the data science terminology. Pre-processing, there are two things in data science primarily, if I can say, tell. Pre-processing and algorithm building. Algorithm building is a 20%, I would say, and pre-processing of the data is the 80% of the work for every data scientist. I can tell you what is the pre-processing and all. Yeah, so many of us might be hear about business intelligence. As an earlier, we used to call it as a business intelligence, because we have a lot of different reporting tools in the market, like OBI, Oracle Business Intelligence, Power BI, Tableau. These are contemporary business intelligence reporting tools. Earlier, we have MicroStrategy, SAP BOS. These are the reporting tools which they can able to dependent on the data, and they can able to only show the report, create the reports and show the results of the existing data. They cannot able to suggest what has to be, what is the future forecast. That is nothing but a descriptive analytics. Descriptive analytics is nothing but which is like going to look at the backward looking. So say for example, if we have the data till today, we can able to create the reports and we can able to see the trend. Okay, in the last month, how was my business performed, and before year, how was my business performed. We can compare year by year or month by month, whatever it is. So basically, you can able to do the analytics in the history of the data or previous data until today's data. Whereas predictive is nothing but future. We can able to predict the future. We can able to identify the future forecasting, forward looking. So say for example, in the similar way, I have the data till 2020. So I am going to look whether I can able to predict something, what is going to happen in the next year, then it is going to be a very big help. We are almost, getting to know the future, how my business is going to perform. So if we know 100%, nobody is going to tell 100% how it is going to be in 2021. Even you have the data, very good data for till 2020, that only God can do. As much as possible, using the techniques and machine learning and artificial intelligence techniques, we can try to find it out how my further future business is going to be. That forecast, we can able to build the models based on the current history of the data. At least some 80 to 90% of the 70, 80 or 90% of the accuracy. If you know 70% of your a future, then it is well and good to plan for it. If you that 30% anyhow, plus or minus 30%, that we can take a chance of it. So if you know 70% or 80%, that is obviously a good number where we can plan for our business. How many let's say for example, if it is a manufacturing company, how many products we can develop. So for example, in 2020, I used to get 1,000 products sales every year, 10% of the growth. Then if we can able to identify, next year it is going to be 1,500 products needs to be built, then I can plan for my team and I can plan to build that those many products. I can ready the infrastructure and everything. So that is how the data science is helping the business to identify what is future need. So that is where the predictive analytics is playing very big, very huge role in the in nowadays. Okay, there are different types of data. What is, the structured data, semi-structured, unstructured. Okay, structured data, you can call it as our historical data, like ERP systems or Oracle, any database, any relational database data, we can call it as a structured data because it will be having columns and rows format of the data. So where we can easily figure it out what is the row and what is the column and we can query out the data and we can look at the data. So that is nothing but a structured data. Semi-structured is nothing but different log files has been generated by the system, computer, and different XMLs and different graph data. These are all nothing but semi-structured data. And unstructured, since we talk about the big data analytics, now since 2000 onwards, the unstructured data is the major is been going very, very, very rapidly. That is because of the social media, the YouTube channels, Google, Twitter, whatever is. These are the three different types of data we have to deal with. So again, in the data science, we can segregate the data into two different types, is a numerical and categorical data. So the numerical data, if you can compare it with the relational database level, then it is a different case altogether. The data in the relational database is different. Whereas in the data science terminology, it is a numerical and categorical, two different types of data. So numerical data is nothing but made of numbers. Like if something we can measure out of a number, like age, height, weight, whatever it is. Categorical data is like we can, some example are like colors of eye and gender, blood type, ethnicity, and all this stuff. And again, there are different types, continuous and discrete. Numerical, we have continuous variables and discrete variables, right? Continuous is nothing but infinity values, so like something like numbers, whereas discrete is nothing but based out of the numbers, but there are some limitations, some starting value and ending values, something like that. Categorical data, ordinal and nominal. Ordinal is nothing but if the data is having a hierarchy. Say for example, in an organization, there are everybody is an employee, but again, based on their roles, the hierarchy has been defined. Manager, and senior manager, and vice president. That kind of data is nothing but a hierarchical data, as well as ratings, high, low, medium, or satisfactory ratings, all this stuff. We can call it as a hierarchy of data. Nominal data doesn't have the hierarchy, that just a string or a text data with describing the different data. So the next, what is the different types of algorithms in the data science? Basically, there are two types of algorithms. We have it in the data science, supervised and unsupervised learning. What is supervised learning and what is unsupervised learning? How we can differentiate this supervised learning and unsupervised learning? I would give you an example of supervised learning. Say for example, I have 10 records in my Excel sheet. Okay, the 10 records are for can we suggest to give a credit card to this particular person or not? This 10 records is having the data with different parameters. Say for example, some 20 to 30 columns values, and at the end we are going to the experts are going to define whether we can recommend, we can give the the column name is, can we give the credit card to this person? Okay, we can have a value as yes or no. So there we are going to define each value as yes, 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 no, no, no. whatever it is, based on these 10 values. So that has been made by an expert. So if we have thousands of applications every day, we need to segregate. We need to segregate that data, whether we can give the credit card or not. Yes or no, yes or no. These many thousands of records every day, segregating this is not an easy task. Even if we have the expert, there are many people are required. Many manual expertise has to be involved in this task to segregate that data, whether we can recommend this product or not. So instead of that, if we can go ahead with the machine learning algorithm, based on that previous data, we can pass it to the machine learning. It is going to read the data. It will train. We can train the model based on that existing data, and we are going to predict the result for the unseen data or whatever the new record is coming to the picture. The 11th record, with that the machine learning itself is going to understand, okay, how this expertise has been defined, this yes or no based on these parameters. It will capture the pattern, data pattern, okay, based on these two values or based on these three values or based on this particular value, is going to recommend this person can give the credit card or not. So based on that pattern, it is going to identify and it is going to put the value either yes or no to the new record. Here we are going to we are telling that the new the target variable, we have a target variable, we have to tell whether it is this record is yes or no. So if we have the target variable to tell yes or no, then it is nothing but a supervised learning. That is nothing but if we have a target variable in your data to be predicted by the machine learning algorithm, then we can call it as a supervised learning. If you don't have a target variable to predict by the machine learning algorithm, then you can call it as the unsupervised learning. That is the simplest difference between the supervised and unsupervised machine learning algorithms. So for the example, unsupervised learning, I can give another example. Say, for example, if you have a students, group of students, 200 students in a classroom, I would like to segregate them into three different groups. Out of these these three groups, I would like to give as intelligent, average, below average. Three groups I would like to segregate. That means I would like I whatever the data I have, I will consider my their academic data as well as their sport activities and their paper presentations or whatever it is, different parameters, whatever the data we have it in with us in the database or in the records. I am going to pick all this data and I am going to segregate that data into three different groups. Here we don't have any target variable to find it out whether we can give it a yes or no or recommended or not recommended. It is nothing like that. It is like we are going to group them into three different groups. That is nothing but three different clusters. That we can call as a clustering algorithm. So that will be fall under unsupervised machine learning algorithm. So where we have the target variable, we can call it as a supervised. Where we don't have the target variable, we can call it as an unsupervised machine learning algorithm. That is the difference between supervised and unsupervised. It can be same for the machine learning or artificial intelligence or deep learning or whatever it is. Same terminology and same concept. Yeah, so this is different algorithms. We can classify it as supervised and unsupervised learning. Supervised learning, prediction and optimization, and unsupervised clustering. We already discussed the students, grouping them into the three different groups as nothing but clusters. Everybody is familiar with the cluster due to the COVID. Why they are telling that there is a cluster? Because of that cluster, we are getting more number of cases. Cluster is nothing but a group. Similarity, where the people is having the similar behavior. That is nothing but a cluster. So that means if they find it out a cluster and where they are getting the more number of COVID cases, they are making it as a red zone. That means that region is having a similar people. That region will be having similar COVID-19 cases COVID-19 affected people. That is nothing but a similarity. Based on that similarity, they are going to tell it as a cluster. Cluster is nothing but group of people with similar behavior. Recommendation. Recommendation is nothing but, say, for example, I would like to tell, if you guys have gone through this Flipkart or Amazon to buy the products, if we can look at some baby product, right, 3 to 4 years, what is the example I can take? Yeah, if we can consider some baby toys for 3 to 5 years, if we can search, later they start giving the recommendations for you to different suggestions. You will get it automatically from the Amazon or Flipkart or Facebook, even from Facebook, kids, dresses or whatever it is, the baby products, powders, whatever it is, we are going to get different recommendations from the from the Flipkart or Amazon, all this stuff. That is based out of the recommendation engines they have made it. Based out of their recommendation engine, they are going to read our behavior. They are going to read our behavior, and they are going to recommend what is the next buying product. Based on the 3 to 4 years, this guy has been searched for the 3 to 4 years baby product, baby toys. That means there is a possibility of buying baby powder. There is a possibility for buying cloths for baby. There is a possibility for other baby stuff. So that is the kind of behavior they are reading from us, and they are recommending it. Even for a YouTube channel also, if you can watch some YouTube video, you're going to get the keep on getting the recommendations for the similar kind of videos. They're also maintaining the recommendation engine. Your Netflix, if you can watch one movie, a thriller movie, they start giving the recommendation for other thriller movies. That is how they're increasing their business. Even if you don't know what is the next movie, thriller movie you would like to...
Tell me. Sorry to interrupt you, sir. If possible, start your video also, sir.
Okay, thank you. Give me 1 minute.
Yes, sure. Yes, sir, thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So the recommendation, they are going to read our patterns based on the whatever we have been watched or whatever we have been searched in the internet. They are taking that and they are going to apply some recommendation engine algorithms, and they are going to give the and further recommendations. That is going to help them to increase their business. Even if sometimes we may not needed that product, by looking at that recommendation, we will try to, okay, why can't we look at, we can try to explore it, and by looking at somehow we can change our mind to buy that particular products. That is how they can increase their business. So, yeah. So these are, algorithm wise, what is going to fall under supervised algorithms and what is going to fall under unsupervised machine learning algorithms. Okay, now, this is one sheet I have been prepared. The supervised, supervised regression, and classification, logistic regression or linear regression, decision tree, random forest, all this stuff. And classification wise, classification is nothing but KNN classification and decision trees. Decision tree can be used for both areas, like a regression problem as well as a classification problem. And the logistic regression, Navi bias, and SVM. There are many algorithms as well, but these are all the algorithms I have been noted down. And for the recommendation engine, a priori algorithm is one of the best algorithm for a recommendation, building the recommendation engines. And clustering and dimensionality reduction, the PCA and SVD and K-means clustering. These are all basically, we can segregate the machine learning algorithms into these parts, and hope you everybody understand what is the supervised learning and what is unsupervised learning, and how it is going to help, what kind of algorithms is falls under supervised and what kind of algorithms falls under unsupervised learning. So this is what I would like to give you an overview on this data science. The next, I would like to take one example and show it to you how it is going to perform in the real time scenario. I have taken a problem for the text classification. As I given you an example, like a medical data related example here, I have a data getting fit from the different people across the country or across the state or whatever it is to a medical agency or a hospital where they are getting these tickets. They have to look at this ticket and they have to segregate whether it is a new appointment related or lab related or any other insurance related and all. That has to be segregated by the manually, it has to be done. And they have to push this ticket to the particular department. That is the task. So for that, if thousands of tickets are getting every day, then it is not an easy task to classify them. It is not at all easy task to classify them. For that, we are going to make use of artificial intelligence or natural language processing to classify this text. I will show you the data first, how it is going to. Yeah, this is my data. By looking at this data, nobody is going to tell what is this, right? So okay, this is my data. Each and every line, each and every row, some person has to read this data, and they have to tell, they have to assign this particular category. Okay, this data, by reading this data, they define that, okay, this is a query for from pharmacy. Okay, this is related to new appointment. This is related to some others. This is related to medical related. And this is for refilling. So this is for rescheduling of the appointment. This is for the lab results. Okay, these are all the several here. How many records we have? I think we have 48,000 records. In one day, these many records are handling these many records, these many tickets is not an easy task. I think it will need at least hundreds of people to do this job. So this kind of job, how this artificial intelligence can able to help to do this job, we will look at this. So I have been segregated this data into two parts. One is the training data and one is the test data. Training data is nothing but where this is having the actual data as well as the categorized data. The experts, some experts has been already defined, this is related to which category and all. So this data, using this data, I'm going to train my machine learning algorithm so that it will get understand how this category has been defined based out of this. So once it is understand the pattern, how to define this particular category, then probably it can able to perform on the other data which is not there in the train, some other test data or whatever it is, the new data. I would like to say the new data. If we can give this converse information to that algorithm, then it is going to print this value. So that is that can do it in a fraction of seconds, where the manually it has to be done in more number of, I mean, maybe in months it will take, but algorithm is going to do it in minutes. Okay, I will show you that. Yeah. this is my training test data where I don't have any category value. I just have the ID. ID is nothing but just sequence number. Around 8,500 records I have it. I have this converse information. Now I am going to predict this category value. So yeah, that is what my problem statement is. And what is the text classification? Text classification is nothing but reading the whole text, and it is going to define what kind of data it is. It is going to print the categories of the text. Okay. The first of all, as a prerequisite, we have to look at the data insights. Okay, the target variable, we have different data like new appointment, cancellation, lab queries, insurance related, general doctor advice, and all this stuff we have as a target variable. That is what we have to predict. If we get the new data, new ticket, we have to print whether it is a doctor advice related or insurance related or new appointment. That is what our target is. Okay, the features are converse. It contains the ticket description. We have seen already. So there are total 48,000 plus number of records are there in the train data. Out of these, 32 records having missing description. We have just category value, but there is no description for it. So that means it is not going to help us anyway. We can just drop these 32 values. We can delete this. Right. The next. Okay, understanding of the data. This is very, very important to solve any data science problem. Okay, this visualization can be done in Python. There is a library like matplotlib. We can use that library to create this graph. Understanding of the data and the visualization, using the visualization. So if we don't need to depend on the coding to understand the data, then we can make use of any reporting tool like Tableau or ClickView or Oracle DVD, whatever the tool, visualization tool you're familiar with, you can download and install, and you can do whatever the exercise visualization, how you can do it with. Here I would like to find it out, to each category, how many records are there? There are 48,000 records are there here, right? There are 48,000 records are there for the different categories. But I would like to see what is the majority of the category I'm getting it in this data. So then here it is medical related at the 8,000 plus, almost 9,000 records are related to medical related. And new appointment is also 9,000. And refill is also around 8,000. So these are the different categories and different numbers. So this is the one data insight. Okay, that means the highest queries we are getting it for medical related. Based on this data, we can understand. Okay, the second highest is new appointment related. The third highest is refill. Okay, the lowest is junk. Okay, the change of pharmacy is very less. Tickets we are getting it. So these are the top four or top five data related tickets we are getting it. Okay, that is how the insights we should find it out. Okay. As I discussed with you earlier, in building any machine learning algorithm, right? So the data pre-processing is going to take 80% of your time and 20% only for the machine building the algorithm. But while building the algorithm, you can try to build different algorithms, and you can apply different machine learning techniques, and out of that you can find it out which is performing better. Based on the accuracy, you can decide end of the day what is the better appropriate algorithm giving the better accuracy and all. But the pre-processing is the same for any algorithm. To build any algorithm, pre-processing is the same. This will take around 80% of your time. This is the important task. Again, the pre-processing for building a normal algorithm is different, and the text classification is different, and image processing is different, and video analytics is different. Based on your problem, your pre-processing steps is also going to be changed. For the numerical data, it is easy to do. You can just scale the data. That means scaling the data means you can keep all the data in the same format and then you can remove the null values, and you can, if you have a particular value, a particular column, if you wanted to fill the null values, you can update the null values and something like that. You have to depend on your data, depend on your problem, you have to do. For the text classification, this is altogether different. The first step what we have done is removing the null values. There are 32 null values in our data. We haven't removed the 32 values. And then label encoding for the target value. Label encoding for the target value. Label encoding is nothing but whatever the data category, whether new appointment or lab related, whatever it is, we are going to convert that data into a numerical value, into a number. Because if we have the numerical data, then the machine learning algorithm is going to perform well. So that is, we end of the day, we have to, if it is a text, right, we have to pass the text as a vector format with a different each word we are going to assign different number, and the group that sentence we are going to make it as a vector, and then the target variable also a number, so that it, machine learning can do perform very well on this numerical data. So we are going to convert this into number format, and we are passing it through the algorithms. Then stop words removal using NLTK. NLTK is a library, natural language toolkit library for Python, where stop words means, for example, you have the data like, this is the sample data. If you can consider tokenization to convert sentence into words. Okay, here, this special character and this dot is not going to play any role. This is not going to help. These two and these words are not going to help in building or predicting the value. So that means these values are unnecessary in any sentence or any data. So we can remove this data, these values, these special characters and all this. That is nothing but removing the stop words. For that, we have an NLTK library. We can make use of that library and we can use it. And then the next step is creating a documents for training and testing data. Creating a documents for train and test data. That means whatever the data we have it in the Excel sheet, right? The train data and test data. That we have to create as a document, and then that document we are going to pass it. We are going to convert, segregate into words. That is nothing but a tokenization. To convert the sentence into words, that is nothing but tokenization. Once we have the tokenization, then we are going to convert the tokenized values into numbers. That means each word, we are going to give one number. And each sentence we are going to convert as a vector, one vector. So that means one sentence is become one vector, one word is become one number, and then the target variable. So this is a padding to create a matrix and splitting the data into 18:20 ratio. Padding, I will explain it in the code. I think it will confuse. Okay. These are the pre-processing steps we have to do it in the text classification. Okay, after building my model, I am approximately got 72% of accuracy and my validation data are unseen data. That means out of 100 tickets, my algorithm can able to perfectly give the result of 72% of the data. That means 72 records, it is giving 100% accuracy. Remaining 28 might be misplaced. That means 72% of accuracy is very good in the real time. So this is how the my model is giving the accuracy. So I will show you it as a practically. So this is the text analysis which I have made it. So these are all the different libraries required to build this model. Okay, different NumPy, pandas. I'm using a Keras model, and in the Keras we have. I'm using that deep learning model for the text classification, like a multi-layer perceptron model. So which the syntax or whatever it is, the steps, we need different dense layers and activation function and input data embedding, and then tokenization and paired sequences, categorical conversion. So all this to Matplotlib. Matplotlib is for the library which is going to do the visualization in the in the Python or in the machine learning. So these are all the required libraries, right? So once we have to import these libraries, we should be installed our TensorFlow and Keras as well. So I'm going to execute it. So okay, the libraries are working fine. So now again reading the data. So now I have test data and the train data. This is my train data and this is my test data. I'm reading this and I'm going to look at the data. So for example, I would like to look at my fire records out of it. So okay, these fire records are, this is the categories and this is the converse, where this is the description in my text data. And again, similar way, I would like to see my train data. Okay, train data, I don't have the category column, which I am going to predict or print. This is my task. Learning from here, predicting here, right? Data that shape is nothing but how many rows and columns are there in the data that we can find it out. Okay, checking for NAs and removing NAs. Okay, for this, actually I need to do this operation for train data and as well as the test data. So for that, instead of doing it in multiple times, I just wrote a function to remove the null values from train data or a test data, whatever it is. So using this function, right? This is my data frame and drop NA. Drop NA is a data frame operation, right? So if we can pass this drop NA to the data frame, then it is going to drop the values, null values. Okay. In place is equal to true means that is going to do it for the data frame itself right away. So that remove NAS function, I have been called it for the train data. This is my train data. And it has 32 values of null values, it is being removed. And again, for the test data as well, I have done the same operation and it is going to remove my null values in the test data. And also I am going to check what is the unique categories. In this, we have 48,000 records in the train data. It is not easy to find it out what are the unique categories, right? We have to go through 48,000 records, then only we can able to understand these many unique records are there. So this is one easy way to find it out what is the unique data in your column. So these are all the unique columns, unique data in the column. All right. So I am going to write this code to find it out the data visualization for each unique category, how many records are there in the train data. So we can change this as any app or based on our convenient. We can write a pie chart. We can write our line. Or we can write our bar chart. Anything we can visualize it in any format. So once we have this data, then the label encoding. The label encoding. I already told you that as a pre-processing, once we remove the, what we did is we remove the NAS already, then next part is label encoding. Label encoding is nothing but simply converting each value in the column to a number, right? Okay, so for that we have scikit-learn pre-processing library. We have an imported label encoder. Okay, we have initialized the label encoder and then this categories column, we are going to convert it to the numbers, right? Okay, we are applying it here. So the label encoder will, it is going to convert the data. So it is converted the categories column into different numbers, different unique numbers it given, right? So now we have this step also. We have done this step. Then stop word removing using MNTK. Stop word removal. Okay. NLTK.corpus, import stopwatch. This is a library already available in NLTK. Once we have installed NLTK, we can make use of these stopwatch libraries. So, okay, the stopwatch, we can call this, we can give any name, and the stopwatch that works English. So it is, we are asking the library to get the stopwatch, list of stopwatch from English language to this variable. Once we have it in the this variable, then we are going to apply this into the for the each and every row. So it is going to remove all the stopwatch and it will print the value. Right, so the 48,000 records it read and it removed the values stopwatch, like there you don't see any two in a the all these values will be gone. That is not going to help to predict anything, so we removed it. So this is the unique categories. Yeah, we are applying this stopwatch removal thing for the even for the test data as well. So we have the train data and test data without stopwatch. So once we have stopwatch removed, what is our next step? Our next step is to create the document for train and test data, right? So we need to create it. For that, I defined a document like empty document and empty label. And document for a test. So now I wrote a for loop. Wherever the value, row value is in data.converse, that means in train data, I'm going to append that to the documents. Similar way, the same logic, I'm going to write it for other test data as well, right? So I'm going to print, just look at the data after creating the document. So it is giving, you can find it out based on this single quotes. Okay, this is one sentence. Okay, the next sentence will start from here to here. The next sentence will start from here to here somewhere. Okay, what it will do is, it will, later we are going to convert this document data into a sequence numbers. That means for each of these word, it is going to assign one number. That means we will be having some different numbers for this particular sentence. This whole sentence can be after assigning the number, this whole sentence can be treated as a vector, one vector. This one vector is equivalent to this sentence. This numerical one vector is going to equal to this sentence. Please remember that. Okay, so the maximum length, what is the maximum length of the converse? The maximum, we have 48,000 records, right? So maximum length is length of data converse. Okay, 48,000 records. So once we have the document, we have created documents for the training and test data, then we need to do tokenization to convert the sentence into words, right? For that, we had a tokenizer model. We have to feed the text on in this tokenizer. Then I'm just print the word.index. It will assign each word one index number. Like, see, for each unique word, it is going to assign one unique number. If the same word is repeating in the different sentences, it will keep the same number. But each unique word, it is going to give us different numbers. So now we have the data converted into words. We have the data segregated into different words. Okay, now convert to sequence after tokenization. Okay, the next step is convert to sequence after tokenization. Okay, convert to sequence is nothing but convert words into numbers. Right, this is the words. This is the conversion of words into numbers. Okay. we are applying this for the training data as well as test data. So it is converting the each word into a number. Okay. So the next step, padding to create a matrix. Okay. Now I'm going to discuss about it. So that means now we have the data, all the data in the numbers format, categorical data in number format, and even for the corpus data, the ticketing data is also in number format with the different vectors. Now we have the data, but some data may be having some 600 words. Some data might be having 400 words. Some data might be having 300 words. Maybe data may not be unique, right? Across the different tickets, it can be different numbers, different words, different number of words altogether. So then if you are passing that type of data to the algorithm, then it is difficult for the algorithm to perform on the data. So for that, we have to chop the data. We define some maximum length. Okay, 500 words only I'm taking it for any from any of the sentence. Okay, even if it is 600, we are going to take it as 500. Even if it is 700, we are going to take 500 as the maximum words. So what if we have less than 500 words? Then we have to manually, or we have to explicitly add zeros to the remaining. If it is 400, means we have to add 100 zeros at the last. At the last or at the first, that is up to you. Here I am doing it as a post padding. That means at the last, after 400, it is going to add zeros like this. So now the every sentence is similar structure. Every sentence is having the same length. That is what we are doing it here. This is for training data. This is for the test data. Both we are doing it. This is the function pad sequences, pad underscore sequences. This is the data document. We have it maximum max underscore length is a value here. We have to pass this 500. I already defined this 500 here. So I given here padding means post. So that means whenever it is less than 500, it is going to post pad zeros. Now it will create a matrix like this. Okay, the next step is splitting the data. This is the last step. Okay, splitting the data into 80 to 20 ratio. Why we need to split the data into 80 to 20 ratio? Because we are going to train the model on the training data, right? So we are going to predict, we have to check whether our model is performing better or not. How we are going to check it out? We can check it out based on the result. The accuracy which has been written to us. To check that accuracy, we need some data. We have to keep some 20% of data for the validation, for the testing. And that is nothing but we are segregating this data into two parts. 80% is useful to train my model, and remaining 20% is for just a testing of a model. That is the purpose of having this splitting the data into 80 into 20 ratio. Okay, right? So here scikit-learn train test split is the library. We can import it, and x train, x test, y train, y test. What does it mean? X train, x test is nothing but your corpus and then target value. Your corpus and then target value. Okay, we are going to use this and padding document and labels, and test size is 0.2% is nothing but 20%, and then. And then this is a random state. Random state means any number you can give. Based on this number, it will randomly it can pick the data. Stratify means based on the labels, it is going to pick the data. So it will convert the data into 20 into 80 ratio. So once we have the data into 20 into 80 ratio for the testing and training, then we can pick our model, any model, whatever you want. Nobody is going to aware of which model is going to perform better in a particular data, because we have to give a hit and try. If we have some 4 or 5 models for that particular requirement, already there are 4 or 5 models available for that particular to solve such kind of problem, then out of these 4 we can figure it out, okay, which model can able to perform better, or else we can also try all these 4 models, and once it has the results, based on the result we can proceed with the right model. That is how we can figure out the models. So this is a sequential model. There are 2 types, sequential and functional. We are taking a sequential model here. And the next step is we are going to adding the embedding layer. There are different layers in this deep learning model, like embedding and flattering and adapts. We have to pass the variables, input length and vocabulary size. This 50 is like output dimension value. And some activation function we have to tell. Here we are using softmax. This activation function is going to, the softmax can be used, most of the times we can use it in the classification problems. And it is going to define the probabilities. Now the output as a probability it will give. So if you have the probability as an output, out of the probability, there are three values it is giving me. So out of that, which is having the maximum probability, we can take that value. That is the purpose of having an activation function. Once we have that the model is done, then we are going to optimize the model. So optimizer can be anything like, there are different optimizers. Here we are using the Adam optimizer, and the loss is a categorical cross entropy. Loss is nothing but whenever we have a classification problem, right? So basically we have to, if it is a multi-class classification problem, we have to use the classic categorical cross entropy loss function. So the purpose of this is how much how accurate our model is, and how much accuracy it is getting deviated from the actual result, how we can able to reduce. Okay, these are all the optimizers can help us to reduce the loss and give the better performance to the near realist values. And matrices, we are going to assess accuracy. There are different matrices we can calculate it, precision, accuracy. These are all can be taken based out of the confusion matrix. So here we are going to, most of the problems we used to take as accuracy. So here we are taking as the accuracy as the matrix. So this is my model. I'm going to print it here. Okay. So in each layer, this is going to learn these many parameters. That is what the output it is showing. Flattern, okay, how many the shape of the shape it is defining, and how many parameters it is going to learn. Okay, this is nothing but 500 into 50 into the input value whatever we have given. If you can calculate these 3 values, then it is going to get this value. The total parameters is these many parameters it learned to perform this task. Okay, so now we are passing the data to the model to find it out the actual values. So this is a format where we can apply the model on the data, text data and train data. So model.fit is the format where we can pass the test data, train data, as well as validation data is nothing but our test data. So epochs is nothing but here we can make it as a 2. That means how many number of times this whole data can be shown to the machine learning algorithm. So here I am just checking as a 2. This is an hyperparameter. Again, you can play with this. Say for example, in the first time I given 1, so it gave some 65% of accuracy. Later I change it to 2, then it is giving some 72% of accuracy. Again I change it to 3, it given again less accuracy. So based on your accuracy value, where exactly it is giving the better value, you can keep that. You can play with these values. So this is the value where it was. If you wanted to see this output here, you can make it as 1. If you don't want it to see, you can make it as 0. Then you will not get this output. So once the model is being built and actual data has been passed to the model, then we are going to print the accuracy. Okay, accuracy on the test. So obviously, when we are printing the accuracy for the trained data, it will obviously give 100% accuracy. Right. So because it has all the values. So it will be able to, there is no point of prediction there because the trained data is having the actual value and the derived value as well, right? We have to predict the accuracy based out of the test value because test data is which is unseen by the machine algorithm. So we are going to predict that. We build the model based on trained data and we are going to pass the model data model to the test data to predict the accuracy. So here 72% of the accuracy I got it. So that means 72%, I mean out of 100, 72 records it is segregating correctly. So this is all print the probabilities of this data. So at last, okay, so I am going to print the our training data is there, right? Well, let me show it to you. Yeah, our training data. Here is the, this is our target. There are around, this is test data. Yeah, there are around 8,500 records here. So which we don't have the category column, where we are going to print the category column for it. So I'm going to print the results as the result.1 in this, and I'm going to run the result.1. Result one just created, but no. Yeah. Now it is given based on this model, it is given the 8,578 categories. It is given so that for this particular one, based on this ID value, we can map it. This particular value, what system is telling that this is the medical related one. The second one, it is telling that this is related to some other activity, other department. So these many values it has been found. This is how the text classification is. It is a little bit different than numerical handling with numerical data because these pre-processing steps are unique. They're different. There are many number of pre-processing steps. And also there are different ways to solve this kind of problems. This is not the only way to solve. There are multiple ways. I am going to share this data as well as this code and this PPT and everything with somebody from university. So I think they are going to share it with everybody. Yeah, this is what. Please let me know if you have any queries. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Ravi sir?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Can we invite queries from the participants, sir?
Sure.
Dear participants, requesting you to post your queries in the chat box or If you raise the hand, we'll enable you to talk to the sir. Sir, one question was raised by Rajender. What is the difference between Jupiter and Anaconda, sir?
Jupiter and Anaconda, yeah, I can show you. This is an Anaconda navigator, right? So Jupiter is an interface where you can write your code in for Python and all. Anaconda is a distribution. It's like a distribution where you have different things. You can write even, you can launch even your R or your Python, R Studio also. It's like a distribution. It's, where Jupyter, it is altogether different. Jupyter is an interface to write your Python code. Anaconda is a distribution. If you can install Anaconda distribution, then you can probably start working with R Studio as well as Python as well. So you can see here. So this is the Anaconda distribution where I have it. So I can able to launch any Jupyter lab, Jupyter notebook, even R Studio, all this stuff. Even here using the Anaconda, it is easy for you to install any libraries. Okay, you can see here what is not installed and what is selected and what is installed. You can search it here and you can click on this and you can apply to install any library. So by default, once you have the Anaconda distribution, you will get Python as well as R. So that is what the difference is.
Dear participants, any other questions?
Yeah, there is a question. Can you please explain
layers in deep learning?
Yeah. Can you please explain layers in deep learning for flatter and dense and other layers, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that's an interesting question. Okay, let me go to that. So basically this is a multi-layer, let me explain him. This is a multi-layer perceptron model. If you can, perceptron input data. It will take the input data and it is going to give the output without having any hidden layers in the network. That is nothing but a perceptron. So if you have the hidden layer in the network, then we can call it as a multi-layer perceptron. Let me show it to you. This is how we have different input values and we are going to get the output. This is nothing but a perceptron, right? Then multi-layer perceptron. So there might be some one or more hidden layers. You can take this example. This is input layer and hidden layer one, hidden layer two, and the output layer. This is nothing but a multi-layer perceptron. So if you have the input layer and output layer, that is the perceptron. If you have input layer, output layer with different hidden layers, that is nothing but a multi-layer perceptron. This is a neural network, right? So here, the next question is, embedding and flatten and dense layers. What is the difference between these two? So embedding is nothing but, basically it is going to reduce the dimensional space. Okay. It is going to translate the high dimensional space into the lower dimensional space. That is the purpose of having the embedding layer in the deep learning model. And then flat run, it is going to mean if we have the it is going to allow us to change the format of the data, shape of the data. It can make it as in some from the vector of two dimension matrix to some flat values. So that is the purpose of having a flat run layer in the deep learning model. So and then the dense. Dense is nothing but dense and sparse, right? You know, that dist- I mean, in the data, all the data is, I mean, be available in very limited area or very nearby. It has not been sparsely distributed. That is connects every. I mean, it is nothing but it will connect every input with every output value. That is nothing but we can call it as a densely connected. Sparsely means it may not have the connection between every input to the output. So it can be a sparsely connected. Some connections might be there, some connections might not be there. Whereas the dense connected means it is going to connect every input value with the output. That is nothing but a dense layer. So that means we are going to reduce the power fitting of the data because it is going to distribute across different the weights are getting distributed across all the nodes or all the layers, so we can avoid the power fitting of the data. So that is the advantages. So most of the deep learning algorithms we can choose because it can handle the power fitting of the data very well. In machine learning algorithms we can end up with some power fitting of the data. So that is the main purpose of having a deep learning neural network models. Okay. Which book reference? Okay, how to classify a medical report consists of multi-modal data. How to classify medical report consists of multi-modal data. Yeah, this is the example. What right away we have done is the multi-modal classification of data, right? It is not two values or three values. It is more than two, three values, right? Which we classified. Whatever the example we have worked on it, that is a multi-classification model. Yeah, dense and flat lens, yeah, whatever I have been explained right now. Dense is nothing but it is going to convert each and every input with output layers. It is not, I mean, you can think in this way, sparse and dense. How the sparse and how the dense in general terms. You can think in that way. Sparsely connected and densely connected. Yeah, definitely I can give some, okay, please refer some free websites to get sample medical data. Yeah, definitely I can share all this information, even this training and test data as well, I can share it with you. You can play with this code and you can change the things and you can execute it. You can change the code and you can try to execute it. So then only you can learn the things. What is the use of padding in CNN? CNN is conventional neural network. That is for the image processing. Image processing or video analytics, whatever it is, end of the day, we have to convert that into some matrix, numerical data, right? So the same way, whatever we have done the padding, if we don't have the, we have been taken some 500 as the number, maximum length, where we can, we are padding the, if we have some strings having the less data, then we are padding the data at the end, right? Similar way, even for the image classification also, once we converted that image into the number format, right? So if we have taken some 50 as the limit or there for the particular image, then we have to pad for the remaining values, whether it is a post padding or pre padding. Any more questions?
Sir, there are two more questions in question and answer session, sir.
Yeah, that we already discussed, right? CNN padding. Yeah.
Let me check in chat room. Naushad Ali Garu, you can ask your question.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Are you fine, sir? Sir, when we can, you told about the Jupyter Notebook and Anaconda, no? Mm-hmm. So when we need to use Jupyter Notebook, when we need to use Anaconda? Better?
Yeah. Basically, Jupyter Notebook and Anaconda is two different things, right?
Yes.
So if you wanted to write some Python code, okay? Yes. So you can write in a Jupyter Lab or Jupyter Notebook. There are other interfaces as well. But whereas Anaconda is like an installer. Okay, it's like a distribution. It's like an installer. You can consider it as an installer. Where you will get all this Jupyter Notebook, Jupyter Lab, RStudio, and VB Code. These all is environment setup and everything, you will get it. It's like an installer, right? So once we have that distribution, you can use any of these tools, RStudio or Jupyter Notebook or anything. If it is a real-time scenario, right, you may not need this Anaconda distribution at all. They will directly give you the Jupyter Notebook they have installed in the server. So you can start working on it. If you are going to practice in your local machine, or if you are going to explain to the students, or whatever, some small exercises you wanted to do it in a Python, so that is better to install the Anaconda distribution. So where you will get Python installed with it, RStudio installed with it, Jupyter installed with it, and everything you will get as a package.
Means in Anaconda distribution, you have Jupyter Notebook also.
Right, that's what I showed you, right? Okay, yes. Here you can see it here. So this is my Anaconda distribution in my personal laptop. Okay, here I have the Jupyter Lab, Jupyter Notebook, so RStudio, I can launch anything. I can install and I can launch anything.
Sir, for beginners in academics, better for Anaconda, no? For beginners.
Yeah, but it's always better to start with Anaconda distribution.
Those who are working in the real time, for the real time, Jupyter.
Real time, yeah, even Jupyter is again different. Okay, if you have the Python installed in your machine, and if you have Jupyter Notebook installed in your machine, if you can able to create the connection between these two, then you can use Jupyter Notebook directly. You don't need Anaconda then. So instead of doing all this stuff, if you install the Anaconda distribution, you don't need to bother about this connectivity setup and everything. You can directly launch the notebook and you can write your Python code, because it is come up with all the software as well as user interface like notebook. So that is the purpose.
Sir, doing research in Malaysia is good, sir, in this field. Is available, sir, in Malaysia? Because I was in Ministry of Education, Saudi. Mm-hmm. So most of my friends, they traveled to Malaysia to do research from Saudi.
Okay. I think many universities are... even in Malaysia also, one of the universities is providing very good research on these data science things. Even Singapore and Malaysia also.
I think, you know, most of the from Gulf, our Indians will come to Malaysia to do PhD. I think you know.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, there is a question has been raised in YouTube as we are having a live streaming. The question is, can we combine two models while training?
Yeah, we can combine multiple models. That is nothing but ensembling. We can combine. out of this, okay, that is one way of one of the techniques to give the better results. That is also one of the good techniques, because that is nothing but ensembling learning. We can combine multiple models like decision tree, random forest, and then all these models when individually we built, then again we are going to combine those models, and that output we can take it as sometimes it will give better results, sometimes it may not give better results. That is also possible. And one more question, what is the advised environment, Jupyter or Thinkorcad? Okay, that is up to the person, how we are comfortable, either with Jupyter or that is up to you. There is no difference. Can you explain how the ETL tools useful in data science? Actually, basically data scientist, ETL tools job is different. As a data scientist, your job is different. The ETL tools can be used by the data engineer. So he will responsible, he is the responsible guy who can get the data from different sources and make this data available for the for a data scientist. So after the data science, data engineer job is finished, then the data science job, data scientist job will start. Once the data is available in the data lake or anywhere, then the data scientist is going to come into the picture to start doing their analytics. So there are two different things. ETL is part of data engineer role. Data science is part of data scientist role.
Sir, one more question which has been raised again from YouTube. Which algorithm is used for early detection of cancer?
Which algorithm is used for early detection of cancer? Okay, so that is again depends on the data we have. Say for example, if we have the, I will give you two examples here. Okay, if we have the data in a structured data, some different records, right? Then we can probably apply one of the algorithms where a classification algorithm, right? Classification algorithm. Okay, whether that particular person can get the cancer or not based on this data. That is nothing but a classification. There are two classes. Either he will get it or not get it. So that, so then that you can use any. So first of all, you have to segregate it like this. Okay, what is the type of the problem? Whether it is a regression problem or classification problem. Okay, here we are going to get detecting whether we are going to get or not. Then it is a classification, falls under classification. So that means once we have the classification decided that there's a classification problem, then we have a lot of algorithms for it. It can be logistic regression, it can be a decision tree, it can be a random forest. You can try, once you have the pre-processing of the data as we discussed, after that you can pick any of the algorithm and you can try to build your algorithm and compare the results between different models. And you can pick any one of the algorithm which can give the better results. That is how we have to do. There is no direct algorithm cannot recommend. Okay, for this particular data, this is algorithm is going to perform well. Nobody is going to tell able to tell that.
Thank you, sir. One more question, sir. Can you give an example for situation to combine categorical data with numerical data?
Situation to combine a categorical data with a numerical data. Yeah, even for any of the data, right, we even for any of the data to apply some algorithms, we may not get the same kind of data. We will be getting some data as a categorical, some data as a numerical, some data, some different formats of some. One column might be categorical, one column might be numerical, one column might be factor. So there are different data you will get it. So as part of your pre-processing, you have to be take care of these values. Like you have to properly convert each and every column. Some the data, even if it is a categorical data, sometimes it will be, initially with the raw data, it can be considered or treated as a continuous variable. Like, So that kind of data you have to segregate it. We have to convert that explicitly in the algorithm before, as a part of reprocessing, to convert whether it is falls under categorical data or numerical data. And that we have to segregate it and then scale the data. Scaling the data means we have to going to keep the all the data in the same measure. Like say for example, if you have the data different data, then you are going to keep the data into some kilograms format, say for example, or else some milligrams format. Yes, so that is up to you how you are going to scale the data. So once you have the scaled data, your model can able to give the better performance.
Thank you, sir. One more question. How can we choose algorithm based on data? As a beginner, can you suggest any online resources to gain knowledge regarding selection of algorithm?
Yeah, regarding the selection of algorithm, this is again we discussed, right? So first of all, we have to decide on what is a regression problem or classification problem. So then what are the different algorithms available for regression? What are the different algorithms available for classification? So out of those different algorithms, we have to pick any one of them. So that I can definitely give the some links which I have it. I can definitely share it with you. Okay, which is the best platform for data science? I mean, best among Python and R. So Python and R both are, R is for statistical learning. For statistical modeling, R is the best tool. Whereas the deep learning modules, deep learning libraries and Python is the best. So I think if you can start, either of the tools you can start with, for machine learning, until machine learning, you can go with the R. For advanced concepts like deep learning and artificial intelligence, you have to go with Python. How can you choose algorithms based on the data? For beginners, can you suggest any online? Okay, that is very all that I can share it with you. That links and all. How to do medical data feature extraction. Feature extraction is always dependent on the domain knowledge, right? So if you don't have the domain knowledge, we cannot able to pick the right data. So we should have the domain knowledge in any of the domain, even banking domain or any other domain, insurance domain or medical related. We should have some domain expert where they can able to help us to prepare the data. So that is where we have to depend on them. Medical data feature extraction and all.
So, as of now, these are the questions have been posed by the attendees, sir. Let me ask again the attendees, still any questions you can post in the question and answer session. Sir is very patiently giving the answers for all the questions, so you can clarify your doubts, or you can raise your hand so that I can allow you to talk. So let me yes, sir. One more question has been given. Sir, how performance metrics are evaluated by Selendra Govindraj?
Performance matrices. Performance matrices is what is question? One second.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sorry, you got a call.
Yeah, no problem, sir. Sailendra Garu, you can unmute yourself. You can directly ask the question, sir. Sailendra Govindarajulu Garu, you can unmute yourself. You can directly ask your question. Sir, he only posed the question, how performance metrics are evaluated.
I think his question is like accuracy, precision, all these metrics are set.
Yes, it seems to be, sir.
Sir, namaste, sir. Namaste, sir.
Namaste, sir. Tell me, sir.
Yeah, hello, sir. Ravi Kumar, sir. I am Dr. S. Govindarajulu, sir.
Sir, tell me.
Sir, sir, I'm just asking about the performance in the sense of accuracy, reliability, and all those things in this aspect, sir.
Right, sir. So actually, that performance matrices, right? The justification can be given by the confusion matrix. I think if you can look at the confusion matrix, sir. So there are four types, like accuracy, precision, and there are some two other things as well. So I don't remember now. So if you, true positive, true negative, false negative, there are four values. Okay. So
yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So some problem, the same problem, some problems. It may be accuracy is the precision. Accuracy might be calculated. Some problems, it may be the precision. That is depends on the problem and depends on the data. We cannot tell that this is the this is the matrices we have to calculate for each and every model. So that is, if you can look at the confusion matrix, you will get to know that.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sir, one more question by Ayesha Maryam. Ayesha Maryam, you can unmute yourself and you can ask the question. Ayesha Maryam, you can unmute yourself or you can ask the question.
Somebody has asked a question. One second.
The same, sir. The same. Okay. I am allowing the person.
Okay. Is the test classification still an emerging research?
Yes.
There are lot of research has happened, and now we can able to create our own chatbots where robots can able to answer our questions. So that means there is lot of research has been done using the artificial intelligence and all. But still, even if you can look at the Google Home. Or Alexa, Siri, Apple. These are all based out of the natural language processing, right? So that is still detecting our voice and converting into the language and processing the speech, and it is going to get the results from the Google or whatever it is. So that means it is doing good now comparatively last 4 or 5 years. But still, it is there are a lot of research are going on. I think in future we may get some better results.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now it is the time to conclude our session. Thank you once again, Ravi sir, for giving a valuable information to all our attendees and to all our participants. May I welcome feedback, because this is the stage where we are going to conclude
sure.
Our session, and this journey of 6 days is going to be concluded with this session. So now I allow the attendees to give their valuable feedback.
Shridevi madam.
Hello.
Sorry, sir. One minute.
Hello.
Dear participants, sorry for the interruption. Yes, so we are going to allow you people for giving you your valuable feedback. Before that, our panelist is going to address all the participants.
Thank you, Ravi Kumar Garu. I hope all the participants had a good pathway in sharing the knowledge. It's a wonderful time to have long query session and questions which can clear everything. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your patience with our participants. Now, it's a time for the valedictory function. I request our HOD, sir, Dr. M. Shivaganga Prasad Garu, to say valedictory welcome remarks. And after that, we'll go on to the valedictory function. Sir, HOD, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Is it audible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Hello. Thank you. Respected dignitaries, for today's valedictory function, Professor Venkatram Garu, Dean Academics, KL University, beloved principal, Professor Subbarao Garu, College of Engineering, KL University, the members of the press, on behalf of Department of Computer Engineering, it is my proud privilege to extend a warm welcome to you all to this very momentous occasion in this history of our department. Department of Computer Engineering, KL University organized a one-week online national level faculty development program on artificial intelligence and Internet of Things applications from 1st June to 6th June 2020 successfully with a group of dedicated resource persons. In the end of this academic year, this is a remarkable academic event organizing by our department, Department of Computer Engineering. This one-week faculty development program saw very enthusiastic participants with undiminished intensity and liveliness. A large number of participants, around 3,000 participants from various academic institutions, research scholars, are actually participated from within India and abroad also. The invited speakers are a set of very eminent, and they are working on a variety of important and contemporary issues on the theme of the faculty development program. The chief guest for our inauguration function of our faculty development program, Dr. RRL Kantham, Registrar KL University, delivered the keynote speech. It was followed by a number of exciting talks on different topics throughout the program. I must thank the voices of this faculty development program as Dr. J. Ravikumar, Associate Professor, Department of ECE, NIT Warangal, Dr. Suresh Kumar Majada, Assistant Chief Technical Officer, Mariculture Division, Center for Marine Research Institute, Government of India, Mr. Ravikumar K., Senior Data Engineer, School of Oracle International, Malaysia, Mr. Ram M.V., DevOps Engineer, Equifax, United States of America, Mr. Vishnu Indukuri, Database Admin, Equifax, United States of America, Dr. A. Kiran Kumar, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, Mr. R. Bhupati, Srimad Krishnaveni of our own department, Department of Computer Engineering, KL University. Must thank all these resource persons once again. And once again, I'm conveying my sincere thanks to all the management, Honorable V.C. Sir, and Dean Academics and Advisory Member, Professor Venkatram Garu, and our beloved Principal, College of Engineering, Professor Subbarao Garu, and all the resource persons, participants, press, faculty of our own department, especially Mr. Dayasagar, Srimati Sridevi Ma'am, and Srimati Aruna, and all the team members of this faculty development program committee. Last but not least, the student organizers. I'm really very happy about this particular organization of this faculty development program. Once again, I'm conveying my sincere thanks to all of you. And this kind of online FDP program gives a lot of immense to the participants, I hope, and all the organizers are done extremely good. And I must thank all the authorities of the KL University once again. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving this opportunity. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, HOD, sir. Now it's time to listen to our principal, Dr. K. Subbarao Garu, COE, in this valedictory event. Sir, principal, sir, please address the participants.
Madam, before that, can you ask feedback anybody, somebody?
Yeah. I request Sridevi Madam to enable the participants for the feedback.
Yes, dear participants, you can unmute yourself or raise your hand so that I'll allow you to give your valuable feedback.
Hello.
Shailendra Garu, go ahead, sir. Govindra Ashu Garu.
Madam, good morning, madam. Good morning, all, madam.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
So, throughout this 6 days FDP, which is conducted by CSE Department of KLU University, I think I have observed lots of things in Internet of Things, data science, artificial intelligence and applications, which are the number of sessions, lot of sessions have been conducted with eminent academic experts and industrial specialists of various companies. So I think really true knowledge transfer has occurred throughout this FDP, and I really, this is a very, very exciting FDP. So I really appreciate the efforts made by all the KLU family members. Thank you very much, madam. Hats off to KLU and the CSE department. Thank you very much, madam. Keep on going, please. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Naushad Ali Garu. Naushad Ali Garu, you can give you your valuable feedback, sir. Naushad Ali, sir.
Is it audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, this is Naushad Ali, having 15 years of teaching experience, both Indian as well as abroad. And I did MTech from JNT Nagpur campus. I know about KL University. It is good university. And this FDP program is, very excellent FDP program. Both the speakers from the academia as well as, from the company side, so industry side. So I am very much happy about this, and especially thanks to the organizers and especially to the Department of CSC KL University. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Vishwanath, sir. Vishwanath, sir, you can unmute yourself.
Yeah, very good afternoon to all. So first of all, I want to congratulate the entire team who is behind this faculty development program. So it was really nice to learn the new things. So as I see, most of the experts are youngsters. So I think this artificial intelligence, machine learning, it's a bit tough for the old generation to accept it. But you made it very simple to all the participants to learn the new things. Thanks for the entire team, madam.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Dayakar Garu, you can unmute yourself.
Yes, madam. This is Dayakar Kunmuni, madam. SNIST, Hyderabad, that case. So I joined lately, after 2 days, but I really enjoyed with the new sessions. But some of the topics needed with practical exposition. This is what I observed. So some topics just come in the presentation, just like PD.
Sure, sir. Sure. We'll improve by the next coming FDPs.
This is my information. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I'm expecting still other participants to give their valuable feedback, as you people are coming continuously or attending continuously from past 6 days with us, and you are giving a valuable feedback with the feedback links providing every day. And that is boosting ourselves to give more exposure towards the content to you people, to share the content to you people. Thank you so much for all the participants for the journey continuing from past 6 days.
Yeah, ma'am, I am conveying one issue to all the participants. Really a wonderful conduction of this faculty development program, real enthusiasm from all the participants.
Hello, HOD sir. Hello,
Madam, it is audible?
Yes, sir. Now it is audible, sir.
Hello?
Now it is audible.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Actually, I want to convey one thing to all the participants in this regard. Really,
hello, sir. HOD, sir. Hello.
Andy?
Sir, we are having a break, sir, in your voice.
Right now, it is okay?
Yes, sir, it is okay, sir.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Please tell me, madam.
Sir, we are not getting your voice, sir. Hello? HOD, sir.
Please carry on, madam.
Okay, sir.
You please carry on.
Thank you, dear participants. Thank you very much for your feedbacks, and we are very happy. And you participants are the strength for the 6 days of conduction of FDP program by Department of Computer Engineering, KL University. Now it's time to listen to our principal, Dr. K. Subbarao Garu, COE, in this valedictory event. Sir, please address the gathering, sir.
Very good afternoon to today's resource person, Mr. K. Ravi Kumar, head of the Department of Computer Engineering, Dr. Sivaganga Prasad, coordinators of this 1 week FDP, and all the participants. A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm extremely happy the way the Department of Computer Engineering has conducted this 1 week FDP on artificial IoT and artificial intelligence applications. And I was told by the department, and also I heard a few participants' feedback saying that how useful this FDP is to all of them. Very good resource persons from various domains have been invited by the department. Experts like Mr. K. Ravi Kumar, Dr. J. Ravi Kumar, Dr. M. Suresh Kumar, Mr. Vishnu, Mr. Ram. Apart from the experts from outside, our own resource persons of computer engineering, Dr. Kiran Kumar, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, Mr. Bhupati, Mr. Krishna, and all these resource persons have made this a wonderful and useful event to all the participants. And this FDP, the area, what the domain, what they have taken, the department has taken, is very apt in the present situation because of the importance in the present era, especially not only in our daily lives, business operations and society. Now the intelligence machines are influencing nearly every facet of our life to improve efficiency. And this particular faculty development program has focused very effectively on this particular issue. And I'm sure each and every participant attended this particular event will be immensely benefited by way of using it in future prospects. And I congratulate once again the head of the department, Sivaganga Prasad, coordinators, Mr. Sridevi, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, Mr. Sagar, and all the other faculty members, non-teaching staff, who are all involved in this particular conduction of the event. And I wish every participant a very best of luck for effectively making use of these outcomes in your further proceedings. I thank the department for giving the opportunity to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So, final announcement for the participants. Participants, I have already told you yesterday about the assignment we are going to conduct today. And you will be having one assignment session with 30 multiple choice questions where 50% is a pass percentage mark and certificate will be issued based on this two events, that is 80% of attendance and 50% of pass percent of your assignment track. And then within 2 weeks, you will be getting your certificate, dear participants. And we are getting into your contact to you. And all the best for your exam, which you are going to attend now. And we are posting the link for the assignment and for the feedback also. It's the time to thank everyone. Nothing can be successful without the support of our great leaders of KL University. I take this opportunity to thank each and everyone from the starting, the organizing committee as partners, Koneru Sachinarayana Garu, Honorable President, Koneru Lakshman Havish Garu, Vice President, Koneru Rajaharin Garu, Vice President, Dr. S.S. Mantha Garu, Chancellor, Dr. Venkat Garu, Pro-Chancellor, Dr. L.S.S. Reddy Garu, Vice-Chancellor, Dr. Ram Kumar Garu, Pro-Vice-Chancellor, Professor R.R.L. Kantam Garu, Registrar Garu. And then special thanks to Chairperson Garu, Dr. M. Sivaganga Prasad Garu, HOD of Department of Computer Engineering, KL University, and all the advisor committee. Without them, here nothing can be done. Professor Dr. N. Venkatram Garu, Dean Academics, Dr. M. Suman, HOD, EC and Deputy Registrar, Dr. M. Ali Hussain Garu, Professor, Dr. K. Kiran Kumar Garu, Professor, Dr. J.K.R. Shastri Garu, Professor, Dr. M. Kamishara Garu, Assistant Professor, Srimati P.S.J. Arunasri Madam, Associate Professor, and all the faculty of Department of Computer Engineering from KL University. And my special thanks to all the coordinators, Srimati S. Sridevi, Assistant Professor, Dr. M. Ramesh Kumar Garu from Department of Computer Engineering, KL University. And a special thanks to the Daya Sagar Garu, who has having this YouTube and the process track, and the media people who is coordinating with us, ENT department, and everyone who is coordinating this 6 days FTP program successfully. And it's time to wind up, I think so. We'll have a national anthem and wind up this event. And once again, it's my sincere thanks to all the participants who are with us and giving support. And we'll post your certificates in mail as soon as possible, basing on your attendance and assessment what you have completed. Thank you. Let us show our respect towards this national anthem.
Madam Arnagar.
जनगणमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ Vanga, Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga, Uchala Jaladhi Taranga, Tava Shubha Name Jage, Tava Shubha Ashitya Mange, Gahe Tava Jaya Gana. Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He.
Thank you very much. Thanks to one and all.